What do you think is the best energy source? And what I really mean is, what's the cheapest? So gas power plants are pretty cheap to install. Coal power plants can run fairly constantly. Solar panels don't need much maintenance. And the huge wind turbines that are popping up in greater numbers every year are very efficient. So I make a lot of videos about renewable energy and wind turbines especially. And I often talk about efficiency and ways to improve it. And every time I do that, I get dozens of totally reasonable comments to the effect of, who cares about efficiency when the wind is literally free? And then the commenter will suggest that the more relevant topic is the cost of the generator, or how many you can fit in a certain area, or which has the lowest maintenance cost. Basically, which is the best and ultimately which is the cheapest energy. So I wanted to make this video to address all of these concerns. It isn't actually very useful to compare just one or another of these factors without considering them all together. And so there is a standard way to combine all of these important things, and that's by calculating the levelized cost of energy, LCOE. That will give you a single number for the overall cost of energy, so then you can compare different technologies with each other. LCOE is calculated using this equation, and I've actually heard that some people don't find equations that exciting. So for those few people who don't find equations very exciting, I'm going to use a race car analogy to explain it today. So this method of analysis was basically invented by Lazard, and their latest version of the analysis has just come out in this very exciting report. So we can use their up-to-date figures to see how the cost of energy compares for renewables versus fossil fuels. All right, so let's go to the race. We're on our way to the start line, and we've got coal, gas, solar, and offshore wind ready to go, and the grid positions will be determined by how much the generators cost. So let's say 500 megawatts, including the equipment cost and everything else that you need to pay to transport, install, and connect to the grid. 500 megawatts worth of utility scale solar panels is the cheapest of the four, so it gets pole position. Second is combined cycle gas, closely followed by onshore wind, and coal power comes in most expensive by a really long way, actually, at over $3 billion. So the capital cost for 500 megawatts of nameplate capacity gives us our starting grid, but the real race hasn't even started yet, because it's not the capacity that, you know, that we use. When we get our electricity bills, we don't buy watts or kilowatts or megawatts. Those are instantaneous measurements of power, kind of like how fast water is coming out of a hose. When we buy electricity, we buy megawatt hours, or on a household scale, kilowatt hours, which is energy, more like how many buckets full of water. So to calculate the cost per megawatt hour, we need to know how many megawatt hours the generator will produce over their lifetime, how many buckets of energy, if you like. To calculate the cost of energy, we need to divide the total production over the generator's lifetime by its cost. And the lifetimes typically vary between 20 and 40 years for the generator types we're comparing. If they were running 24/7 at 100% of their nameplate capacity, then you would get 4.4 million megawatt hours each year of their operating lifetime. But no generator operates that much. Solar doesn't work at night or on cloudy days. Wind turbines don't turn when there's no wind. Coal and gas power plants ramp up and down depending on demand, and all kinds of generator have a little downtime for scheduled and unexpected maintenance. If we look at the average figures in the latest LCOE report, we see coal with the highest capacity factor at 66% and solar with the lowest at 23%. So to compare those, you would need three times as much solar capacity as coal to get the same output. And because the coal plant lasts longer too, 40 years for coal versus 30 for solar, overall, you'd need about four times as much solar panels to give the same total amount of energy over their life as one coal power plant. So gas here has a 50% capacity factor, which is the average for combined cycle gas. But peaking gas plants are run with a low capacity factor, on average about 10%. They only run to supply demand spikes. The Australian government is planning to build a new gas peaker in Kurri, and it's only expected to have a capacity of 2%. So that means it's only expected to run on average a total of about 1 week per year. And to continue digging in just to fill out the picture, the average capacity factor given for wind is 38%. That's for onshore wind. And there is a trend more towards offshore wind, and this is mostly because you can get really good capacity factors offshore. Over 50% is pretty normal there. But that does come with a trade-off that equipment and other costs are higher offshore. So combining all this, once you factor in lifetime capacity factor, we get a cost per megawatt hour based purely on how much the equipment costs and how much electricity it will produce in its lifetime. So let's go back to the race, and we can see things have changed a lot. Solar is still the cheapest, but gas is now close behind, followed by wind. And coal has caught up most of its initial handicap due to having the highest capacity factor and the longest operating life. So the race is really heating up. But that's just for the capital cost, so we need to add everything else. So now we head to the next corner, which is financing costs. How much it costs the company to get the money it needs for the project. Using a weighted cost of capital of 7.7%, over a 20-year project lifetime, the capital recovery is going to double the cost. For longer project lifetimes, it's more. And that assumes all energy types have access to the same rates. But in reality, these days we're seeing coal projects having trouble accessing good finance terms compared to renewables projects. That's because wind and solar projects are seen as less risky than coal, and they therefore attract more favorable terms. So you can imagine that building a new coal power plant now with an expected 40-year lifetime. So if you're a bank that wants to lend to that project, you need to factor in the chance that in 40 years things will change and that coal power plant may very well not be profitable anymore and might not be able to pay them back. After we add in financing costs, gas has overtaken solar and snuck into the lead. But can it stay there? Oh no, what's this? Gas and coal are pulling in for a pit stop. They need fuel. But the wind and sun are free, so they don't need to stop. They're making up time. To calculate the fuel cost per megawatt hour, we need to know the energy content of the fuel and its cost. To put this into the LCOE formula, we use the heat rate, which is a slightly weird unit, BTU per kilowatt hour. BTU is British thermal units, and BTU and kilowatt hours are both energy, just in different systems. There are 3,412 kilowatt hours in a BTU, so you can divide the heat rate by that to get the efficiency. So the efficiency is kilowatt hours of heat energy compared to kilowatt hours of electricity that comes out of the generator. And just to complicate things even further, the heat rate varies depending on the quality of the fuel source. So for coal, it's between about 8,700 and 12,000 normally, but sometimes can be lower for very good quality coal. And for combined cycle gas, it's about 6,000 to 7,000. So putting that in terms of efficiency, it's around 28% for a coal power plant and 50% for combined cycle gas. And if we just want to compare that to the efficiency of renewable energy sources, a good wind turbine's a little at 50% efficiency and solar panels somewhere around 20%. But as you guys like to point out, who really cares because the wind and the sun come for free. For coal and gas, though, the fuel cost matters a lot. Obviously, the price of these commodities goes up and down, and at the time of recording this, the price of gas in Europe was through the roof, as high as 110 euros per megawatt hour a few weeks ago, which is about 37 US dollars per million BTU, more than 10 times its recent average of $3.45. If you add that cost in, your LCOE for a gas generator, it just becomes ridiculous, as unfortunately Europeans are learning the hard way right now. But let's just assume that will probably eventually settle down again. So let's use average prices to estimate how much fuel costs are going to add to the LCOE of gas and coal power. So where do we end up after our fossil fuel pit stop? Coal took a $24 per megawatt hour hit, and gas, when you use average prices, $17. By the time gas and coal get back on the race course, solar and wind have gone through, and so now we have renewables leading the race as they go to the final corner. The home stretch of our race course is operations and maintenance. Each generator type has fixed maintenance cost each year, no matter how much was generated, which is kind of like how you still need to change the oil in a petrol car, even if you barely ever drive it. And those fixed costs include the cost of leasing land. And then fossil fuels also have a variable maintenance cost per megawatt hour generator, which is kind of like replacing the timing belt in your car every time you drive 100,000 kilometers. For O&M in total, solar has the lowest cost by a long way, followed by gas. And then wind has a fair amount of maintenance required, as does coal, so their costs are higher. And that was the last component of our LCOE calculation for each technology. So after all that, here's the checkered flag. In 2021, solar comes in the winner, followed by wind. Then the fossil fuels are actually a fair way back. So that is LCOE by way of race car analogy. And I mentioned at the start that the values for each of these parameters were taken from Lazard's latest LCOE, which is version 15. That report gives a range of values for each technology, and we used the high case in this analysis shown by the pink dots here. You can see in this chart that the contribution that each component of LCOE made for each technology. And if you want to play around with the assumptions, then you can head to keynumbers.com and they have a really good dashboard where you can play around with each parameter and see the effect that it has, including adding a price on carbon emissions in case you think that there should be an incentive to, you know, not treat the atmosphere like a free public sewer. So when I was doing a bit of a sensitivity analysis on the LCOE, I was a bit surprised actually to see how big of an influence the financing costs have on the LCOE. And then also the fuel cost. These two combined are probably the most unpredictable aspects of the future LCOE. So if we see fuel costs stay high in the future and financing costs rising for fossil fuels compared to renewable energy projects, then these two things together could really dramatically widen the growing cost advantage that renewables have over fossil fuels. LCOE publish an updated version of their LCOE every year, and since 2015, wind and solar have been the cheapest. In fact, by now, even the marginal operating cost of operating a fossil fuel power plant, so that like assumes an older power plant where they've already paid off the cost of the capital, even in that case, the marginal cost of fossil fuels is higher than new build wind and solar in a lot of situations. So that's it, right? Wind and solar are the cheapest and getting cheaper. End of story. Energy transition solved, yeah? If renewable energy is the cheapest, then anybody who likes money should have already stopped building fossil fuel power plants as soon as renewables got cheaper than fossil fuels. But that happened 6 years ago, and we are gradually using less fossil fuels, but it's certainly not disappearing completely yet. Why? So it is true that wind and solar have won the race for the cheapest electricity production, but that was pretty much just the easy part of the energy transition. As we get more and more variable renewable energy in the grid, the cost of energy becomes less and less relevant, and we start to have to worry about the availability more. And so LCOE on its own can only take us so far when we compare different energy sources. I used the analogy earlier, and yeah, I know I've used like really a lot of analogies in this video. I compared megawatt hours of electricity to buckets of water, but there's a key flaw with that analogy. You could put coal in buckets and wait to make electricity with it when you want, but you can't put like wind and solar generated electricity in a bucket for later. You have to use it when it's made. So super cheap renewable electricity is great, but only if you can use it when it's generated. If you want electricity at night, it can't come from solar on its own. In that way, it's not 100% relevant how cheap solar has become. I mean, it's not the full story. There's obviously a time of use component that we need to add to LCOE if we want to get the more complete picture. And there is a concept to do this. It's called value-adjusted LCOE, VALCOE. And it does that by comparing not just the cost of the electricity generated, but also its value at the time of production. And this chart from the IEA shows how the value of different energy technologies will change as we increase the proportion of variable renewable generation up to 50%. So when there's a lot of solar power in an electricity grid, it all comes on at a similar time if, you know, the solar panels are near each other, leading to an oversupply at those times and therefore lower and sometimes even negative prices. The cost of that solar energy calculated with LCOE is very low, but the amount of energy that the solar panel owner can get for that energy is also low. So the value-adjusted LCOE reflects that. And at the other end of the spectrum, we have gas turbines, which have a high cost per megawatt hour, but their operators can choose when to turn them on. So they'll only generate at times when wholesale prices are fairly high, which might be because there's not that much wind or solar available, or, you know, maybe a coal power plant exploded or something like that. So they don't operate all that much, but when they do, they get paid well. So they have a high value adjusted LCOE. It's worth noting that this infrequent operation also means that their greenhouse gas emissions are reduced relative to if they were operating with a high capacity factor. So that's one reason why I think we'll probably see gas turbines continue to fill gaps in wind and solar generation well into the future and, you know, like gradually reducing as other energy storage options come on board, like batteries. And I'm not that worried about it. I'm not that worried about the emissions from new gas generator like the Australian government Kari Kari one. If it's only used a tiny bit, then it'll only release a tiny amount of emissions. So it might be a big waste of public money, but at least it won't have that much of a climate impact. So value-adjusted LCOE, it adds something, but it's still not telling the full picture because it projects into the future based on today's operating environment. In reality, no one's going to be investing in more solar farms if they're mainly working during periods where there's negative electricity prices. But if we continue to see a lot of negative prices on sunny days, followed by price spikes in the evenings, and that's the basis of this duck curve chart, which you've probably seen before, if this persists, well, then batteries and other forms of energy storage are going to start to look pretty attractive to investors who want to do a little energy arbitrage. They'll get paid to charge their batteries on sunny days and then get paid even more to sell that power back in the evenings. So the more storage we get online, the less price extremes we'll see, smoothing out that famous duck curve a bit, and meaning that the real value-adjusted LCOE when we reach 50% variable renewable generation, it will probably look really different to how it's predicted to now. If you want to hear more about these kinds of changes in the energy system, then check out this video I made with renewable energy finance experts and podcasters Laurent and Gerard earlier this year. And if you want to support the channel to make more videos like this, then you can join the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team, and we would love to welcome you to the exclusive Discord server to chat all things clean tech and help shape the future of the channel. I just wanted to pop back in because while I was editing this video, I could tell that there was a bit of a gap, and I knew I would get comments telling me that dollars are not the only value that's relevant here, and I definitely agree with that. So I wanted to mention that whilst we've been really focused on the cost, bringing the cost of renewable energy down over the last decades, which is a great thing, obviously there are other values that are important. There is also the value of not emitting CO2 into the atmosphere, which I did mention briefly, but I also just wanted to add there's a bunch of other factors I didn't mention earlier, like biodiversity, having uninterrupted views, having local jobs, health impacts from particulate pollution. All of these things and many more are relevant to which energy source we choose. And I don't really think we've done a great job at making conscious decisions about which of these we value as communities. And it's something that I hope we're going to get better at over the next decades. I'd really like to see sensible discussions about the trade-offs that we need to make between all of these factors, since, you know, no technology is impact-free. And waiting for a perfect energy technology to come along is just going to guarantee climate catastrophe because it's just never going to happen. Anyway, that's pretty off topic, maybe something for another day. I just want to finish by giving a big thanks to John Poljak, the founder of Key Numbers. He did all the calculations for this analysis, and he also picked up in a draft I showed him what would have been an embarrassing mistake in one of the figures. And he was the one who suggested the racing analogy. So thanks, John, for making this video more interesting and more accurate. And thanks to you all for watching. I'll see you in the next video.